Good afternoon, my name is Gwendal Grignoux, and I'm going to talk about more sensors. Not the fingerprint sensor, but will be the small ones like accelerometer, gyroscope, magnetometer, light, and what we find in the Chromebooks. So, here we are. So, Morbox. This slide is the current implementation, and there is boxes everywhere. So the sensors are here. We have the sensors. They are connected to the embodied controller. And for each different sensor, we have a driver. Then we have the embodied controller. There is a common interface over different type of bus to connect to the kernel. So, and then you have the cross EC sensors at the top of the cross EC stack that present through the IIO CCFS interface different sensors. So we have the accelerometer, gyroscopes, and then a driver, the cross EC sensor ring. And what we have, the use case of the sensors is twofold. So it has been introduced first for with convertible. The first one was Samus in 2015, and it's used by Chrome to calculate the lead angle on the rotation, like landscape or a portrait. And this block has been added when we developed the Pixel C. So it's running on Android, but using the Chrome OS kernel. So we have HAL that's access all the sensor. And the ring sensor is a requirement for the cross EC sensor HAL, which use push model, where all the events are going naturally from the sensor to the EC. Whereas Chrome, which is a little more ancient, use a pool model, which gather the event from time to time. Another thing which is interesting is the cross EC HAL has an extra sensor for coming from Chrome. So it's a private sensor, and Chrome decides to calculate the orientation, because the orientation is not just if the screen is on portrait, but if you have an external monitor, the rotation change as well. And then the Android, instead of using the accelerometer to calculate itself the rotation, use that sensor. So that's the blocks that cover the current implementation. And if we go a little bit inside how the sensor works inside the Chrome OS, I have a nice time diagram. So life of sensor data starts on the upper right. So the sensor, most of the sensor will trigger an interrupt to the EC when there is a sensor event available. The EC is gathering the event. And then when the EC feels it's time to send the event to the host, it will trigger an interrupt. It might not be for every event. We support batch mode, which is required by Android. Although very few applications use the batch mode in R++. So we have the interrupt. The interrupt is for all the whole ECs, not just for the sensor. So the cross EC stack needs to know the source of the interrupt. So that's why it's on the get next event. So sensor piggyback on the keyboard subsystem. So we use what we call the MKPB protocol, and the EC will send some information about why the interrupt has been triggered. The cross EC stack use the notifier API to call everyone, say, "Whoa, I have an event. Who wants to take care of it?" And then the sensors will say, "Okay, that's a FIFO event. I'm taking care of it." We can send an extra event here, but usually we don't, because we have, because we piggyback on the keyboard subsystem, we have like 13 bytes, and we can use that information to get together some information. We still have together the sensor information. So we gather the sensor information to the arm. Then for we may have more than one sensor information batch, or if you have several sensors that's been triggered interrupt. And then for each sensor, we fill a buffer. We fill a data structure in a buffer on this. The sensor AL is picking up on is pulling on this buffer, like it's called IO device, and then it's calling on reading that file and gets the sensor information. So that's how it works. It's not that difficult, but it's challenging, and I'm gonna present one particular challenge. So one thing is which is a little bit difficult is the time domain transition. The EC works is in own time domain, and the AP has its own time domain, and they need to be synchronized. So I'm gonna use a variable. So no, if in a perfect world, if that's the A is the time where the sensor produces the sensor event in the EC time domain, and B is the time where we interrupt the host, and C is the time where the interrupt is received by the host. In an ideal world, the timestamp of the sensor data in the AP time domain is C minus B plus A. C minus C minus B plus A. And that should work. Unfortunately, that doesn't work very well. So usually the sensor generates event at spread event evenly. It might not be the data rate you ask for. There may be some variation due to temperature or other factor, but usually it's pretty constant. The interrupt happens when it happens. And the problem is the time between the host, the EC triggering the interrupt and the host receiving the interrupt is actually not constant. And that will in consequence, the time in of the sample in the AP time domain, I call E prime, will not be even. Well, that was fine at the beginning for games or like for application where not recurring sense tight timestamp, but for application that does, and in particular AR core, when we decide to support AR core, that doesn't work anymore. We have to do something. So what we did, we added a medium filter. So the idea of a medium filter is, let's imagine you have a spike in interrupt from time to time. With the median filter, assuming you don't have spike too often, and the spike is less than the depth of your filter, then the median filter can weed it out. That's the theory again. And what we find out, that was working fine on ARM, but not at all on Intel. Why? Because the EC doesn't use a real interrupt. They use a message-based interrupt through a CPI, and therefore, when the EC wants to send an interrupt, he sends a message that will be processed by the CPI interpreter in the kernel, and then the CPI interpreter will call our driver. And the problem is the timestamp. So we only see the bottom half of the interrupt handler. And that's not a good source from time stamping. There is too much variation. And even with the medium filter, we are not able to clean up the timestamp. So what we did for AR Core, we added a kind of at the 11th hour, we added a requirement that, oh, if you want AR Core, you need to have hardware interrupt between the AC and the AP. And that helped things. We on the newer platform, that helped a lot, and that helped also pass the CTS test, so which was good. And talking about AR Core, we had another sensor, well, kind of a sensor. So what you have is the camera is slightly modified to have the V-Sync as an output on the GPIO to the EC. And then we have a very simple driver that will convert the GPIO into a sensor. And then we present that information through IIO sensor, a counter. So it's super trivial, actually. Each time we have a change in the, we have a GPIO change, that increment the counter and that goes to the IIO interface. But the beauty is that we are in the same, the counter on the gyroscope is in the same time domain with the same error, with the same imprecision, but it's the same. So this way we can actually merge the camera information with the gyroscope information, which is critical for AR Core and also for camera, if you want to do image stabilization, for instance. Another issue we solve on the sensor side was that on the was Kevin, we were using like, at least 2% of the CPU just gathering the sensor, the accelerometer information. So there was some imprecision in the driver. We were reading too much data from the spy bus. But anyway, the main problem is why do you need to gather sensor information when you idle, when your device is sitting on a desk, especially given that the EC is already calculating the lead angle. We need that so that we are not waking up when you are when you suspend your device or your device is suspended in tablet mode. You don't want to be wake up when you have a key press. So the EC is already calculating the lead angle, and there is already an interface in between the EC in the input subsystem for user space to listen to if they want to know if there is the current tablet mode. It's called an EV event switch. There is already event switch for tablet mode. So we tied everything together, and if the lead angle we calculate the lead angle, we present an inclinometer device, which is, nobody uses it, but at least it's there. It just represents what the EC is calculating. And now, when the Chrome is relying on the tablet mode switch to go in tablet mode or go in desktop mode. And the tablet mode switch is tied to the lead angle calculation. So this way, when you are in desktop mode and you are using latest Chromebook with kernel 4.14 or above, the Chrome is not wasting time for the calculating the lead angle and probing. It doesn't probe the accelerometer anymore in desktop mode. In tablet mode, we still do gather the lead accelerometer to calculate the orientation, tablet or portrait or landscape. And actually, that's kind of a waste. We could have similar mechanism with event based. Unfortunately, portrait landscape, we don't know if it's we don't have a proper subsystem for it. It's not input, it's not IIO, so we need to find something else. And to be upstreamable, we haven't found anything so far. So that was that's what we have today. And on the sensor side, we actually need to do some work for the future and the near future is ArcVM, because this solution, the solution we have currently, it's assumed that the sensoral can access the CCFS interface, and with ArcVM that doesn't work at all. So we need to change that. And what we need also to change is the cross-EC sensoring, which was introduced for the Android, was a mistake. And I took a design from another tablet manufacturer. In retrospect, that was a mistake because it's not tunable. So every kernel, we have to port this driver over and over. It's a waste of time, and it doesn't make any sense. And also another issue, have you seen before? The Android got all the sensors via the push model, where the sensor events are flowing to Arc. Whereas other clients, it's a pull model. They have to ask the events. So that's not great. That's not a very nice design. So what we're gonna do? We're gonna for cross sensoring is not optimable. We're gonna get rid of it. The inefficient access for other Arc++, we're gonna add a service in user space. And this service will make it VM compatible, so that we'll be able to use it with ArcVM. So the sensor hub. So the sensor hub is not rocket science. If you look at the HID stack, you have already this concept of hub between the driver and the sensors that spread the event coming from the EC. And then instead of listening to one file, you have to listen to all the sensor IO device file. So that works. Obviously, if you just do that, you have a problem. It's given only one application can listen to IO device. The Chrome cannot listen to the accelerometer anymore. So how do we fix that? So we need a user space component, and the de facto standard to access IIO sensor from user space is to use IIO, libIIO. So libIIO, the libIIO has a different backend. So the most obvious one is the local backend, which via a C interface allow access to the IO CCFS attribute. And if we use the IIOD server, we have actually more backend. So what the architect of the IO subsystem and the writer of libIIO have designed is the way to access remotely the sensor. So there is already existing backend. One, it's a USB using a serial profile. And the other one is the network socket using TCP/IP. IOD is listening to a port and you can connect to it. And then the client is using libIIO. The interface, the API the client use, it's the subset is pretty common. I mean, the local the API of local the API of the network socket or the USB socket is a subset of the local API, but still it's usable. So if you write your application properly, it doesn't matter which backend you're using, you access the sensor the same way. So here, for example, if you have an application, we use the network backend, go through network link, the libIIO receive the packet. And the libIIO here connect through libIIO using the local backend and access the IO device. So why we are, using libIIO allow us to have, reuse the code that has been done to access IIO device over the network. We have already a well-known protocol to talk to the sensor remotely. And also, we'll be able to upstream the change that give extra pair of eyes to review the change we want to make to the libIO when we have to. So what's the block looks like now? So every client, so now we can have more than one, we can think of more than one client like Chrome, PowerD, or Camera Al can use libIO via a new backend, the socket interface. And Android can use socket if they're running in Minigel, or vSocket if using in a VM. Connect to the IO service, which use the libIO as a local. And then we have IO service use libIO with the local backend to access the sensor. So I mentioned IO service. Why not using IOD directly? So we need a beef up server for the sensor. So that's why we're going to rewrite IOD in C++. One big change is how we send events, sensor information to the clients. So normally what happens is if you have several clients connecting to the IOD and the sensor arrive, the sensor events arrive to IOD, IOD will spread the sensor, will broadcast the sensor to everyone. So in our case, if you have Android asking for a sensor like 150 Hertz and Chrome has a much lower frequency, you don't want to overwhelm Chrome with too many sensor events. So you have to spread. To spread. So in this example, let's imagine the sensors usually support a limited amount of frequency. So let's imagine they support only 125 Hertz and 250 Hertz. And Android is asking for the sensor to work at 150 Hertz. To meet the requirement, we're going to set up the sensor to work at 250 Hertz. And we don't want to send sensor event to Chrome at 250 Hertz. So every 13 events, we're gonna send an event to Android, to Chrome. So Chrome will get this sensor at a frequency about 19.23 Hertz. So that's that will meet Chrome requirement without overwhelming the Chrome process. And another thing we want to do is the IO service to be configurable via Chrome, from Chrome. So for instance, if you want to enable or disable sensor access to virtual machines, or if you want to tune the service. So as I said in the slide before, we need to add for libIO, we need to support new backend, which is it's socket based, so it's very similar to the network backend already existing, but will be the Unix domain on the vSox. And so when you see this is scary when you see this this architecture, because it's very different from what we have today. So that will be an interesting mega question, but. We hope to be ready for ArcVM. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna first change a little. We're gonna keep the ring driver, but we're gonna introduce libIO to the clients only with the local backend. Then we add the IO service just for Chrome, not for the Arc++ yet. And then when we are ready, we go to the final implementation. And then we are ready to move to ArcVM. So yeah, that's the work we are doing right now. If we look at the future work, like when everything is done, what is nice with the IO service is we will be able to support guest OSs with very little modification. Actually no modification. So in the case of Windows rely on the HID protocol, which is, mentioned before with the input. It's a subset of USB, but now it's on live. So HID define how sensor information can be reported to the host. So what we have here, we create a virtual I2C controller, which we present to the VM. On top of the virtual I2C controller, we create a virtual HID of I2C device, which report a collection of HID sensors. And Windows will load the proper driver for those devices, for the HID over I2C and the HID sensor driver. And then, connected to Libre.io, we can send the request coming from the Windows VM, translate HID request into a Libre.io request, go to a service, which will translate the request from Libre.io to a SysFS call, which will be translated by cross-EC sensor hub into a request for the EC, which will translate it to the sensor, to the real sensor. That's investigation in progress, because that's a lot of translation. We'll have to pay attention to the timing. But that's very enticing to be able to use a pure guest OS without modification and be able to use existing code to access the EC. So yeah, that's the future.